Welcome back to the Presbyterian Journey. I'm the Reverend Lucus Levy Keppel, and this is the eighth part of our series. Like a hummingbird, we're going to flit from one place to another. So if you have any questions, please ask them in the comments below, or ask your pastor, who can provide deeper resources than anything I can provide here. Last week, we ended by talking about schisms in the Presbyterian Church that trace back to the fundamentalist-modernist debate. The history of the PCUSA is not entirely about schisms, but also merges. Today, we're going to jump ahead to 1958, when the United Presbyterian Church of North America, UPCNA, merged with the Presbyterian Church in the United States of America, PCUSA, to become the United Presbyterian Church in the United States of America, UPCUSA. After the union of these two churches, a request was brought forward to revise the Westminster Confession, which still held primacy as the confession to which all ordinations must subscribe, or at least scruple. But by 1958, the Westminster Confession was over 300 years old, and much of the language had shifted, making it harder for ministers to accept without scruple. After committee studied Westminster, trying to find ways to revise it, the task was dropped, and instead the committee was tasked with writing a new confession for the church. Unlike the Westminster Confession, this new confession of 1967 did not try to fully encapsulate all theology into a single document. Instead, it lifted out particular theological arguments, especially regarding reconciliation, as it applies to racism and sexual promiscuity, as well as international relations, gender politics, and technology. Alongside this confession of 1967, the denomination adopted the concept of the Book of Confessions, containing all of the confessions we've talked about so far in this series. They also altered one of the ordination questions fairly significantly. It changed from, "Do you sincerely receive and adopt the Westminster Confession of Faith and Catechisms of the Church as containing the system of doctrine taught in Holy Scripture?" To reflect these changes. The new question now reads, "Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith, as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable exposition of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God?" This concept of the Book of Confessions was meant as a recognition that our understanding of God's Word changes over time, and we need to be able to express that understanding. It functions as a recording of how we have strived to faithfully interpret Scripture and live lives steeped in God's Word, and a recognition that we are reformed and always being reformed, even in our confessional statements. In addition to the confessions we have already discussed, the Confession of 1967 explicitly refers to the Theological Declaration of Barmen from the 20th century. To understand this confession, we once again need to travel to Europe, to the heart of the industrial powerhouse of Wuppertal, historically known as Barmen-Eberfeld. The year is 1934, and one of the earliest Nazi concentration camps for political prisoners has just closed down within a former factory in the city. A meeting of Lutheran, Reformed, and United Church leaders produced a document that consists of six articles, each with an affirmation of a historical theological precedent and a rejection of a misuse of that particular precedent, pointedly referring to the actions of the German state church. This meeting of church leaders is especially amazing, considering that just a century before, these denominations were state-supported themselves. In the German Empire under Kaiser Wilhelm, each German state supported a specific denomination. Church taxes were collected by the state and distributed to each state church. So-called free churches were tolerated, but did not receive state funds. These state churches were determined by historical precedent, so Lutherans were supported in historically Lutheran states, Catholics in Catholic states, Reformed in Reformed states, and so on. After the First World War, these state churches were officially abolished, but remained public corporations and retained subsidies from the secular government. In this Weimar Republic era, church councils found themselves invested with more local power than before, though without time to adapt to this new model. As the Nazi Party rose in popularity in the secular world in Germany, a part of the Prussian church found that it could control church councils to make the way clear for authoritarian regimes in both the secular and sacred realms. This became the seed of what would become known as the German Christian movement, or Deutsche Christen. These German Christians in 1933 were officially elected to become the state church in all but four states of Germany. It is opposition to this German Christian movement that met in the Barmen portion of Wuppertal. Calling themselves the Confessing Church, they demanded non-interference from the government. Unfortunately, their first response, known as the Bethel Confession, did not gain support. Though it began strongly, the Bethel Confession sadly fell apart under committee, and it lost a lot of its power to speak against the state church. And the committees even removed references to the suffering of people, especially Jews, under the Nazi regime. Though we remember little about the Bethel Confession today, its original author of the strong version is well remembered. His name was Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a part of the German United Church. He earned his Doctor of Theology degree at the age of 21 in Berlin, and spent time in New York as a professor of Union Seminary, which we spoke about in previous episodes. He strongly opposed Nazism and campaigned actively against the German Christian movement. After the watering down of his Bethel Confession, Bonhoeffer participated in the Barmen Declaration and formed an underground seminary in Germany, teaching pastors apart from the German state church. He was arrested by the Nazis for assisting with an assassination attempt on Adolf Hitler, and was killed in a concentration camp in 1945, just a month before the camp was liberated. His legacy as a brilliant theologian and scholar, professor and resister, is a powerful voice to the church, even if the Bethel Confession that he wrote did not achieve what he hoped it would. But let's turn back now to the Theological Declaration of Barmen, back in 1934. It formed a strong rejection of the Nazis and the German Christian movement, and was primarily written by the Reformed theologian Karl Barth. Remember that this is a series of affirmations and rejections. In brief, the six articles are, first, that Jesus is the one Word of God, and that the Church rejects any other revelation. This was intended to deny that Hitler could claim special revelation over doctrine. Second, that it is Christ who forgives all sin and thus claims all of life, rejecting that anyone or anything else can have a claim to one's life, showing that the Nazis could not claim that Germans belonged first to the state. Third, the church must act as Jesus did in the world, and so the church rejects churches formed solely along ideological lines. Fourth, officers of the church, that is, pastors, bishops, elders, etc., are not imposed from the top down, so the church rejects leaders being imposed on it from the secular world. Fifth, the historical separation between church and government means that the church rejects taking on government functions. Lastly, the freedom of the church to spread its message of grace means that it must reject subordination of the Word of God to secular plans. While the Theological Declaration of Barmen did not state anything that was particularly new theologically, it stated it directly and with the promise of and purpose of showing false doctrine in the church in light of the truth. For this reason, it stands as a part of the Book of Confessions as an example of how theological truth can be applied in particular places and times to great effect. The Confessing Church may not have had official recognition within Germany, but it was recognized as a resisting group by the wider world. I'm afraid that's all the time we have for today. But next week, we'll be heading back to the United States for the reunification of the Northern and Southern Presbyterian churches and the establishment of a new headquarters in Louisville, Kentucky. Thank you for joining me on this Presbyterian journey. May the light of God always shine through your heart.